What happens when you've hired someone, you've worked with them in the clinical supervision process, you've provided staff development, and there just reaches a point where things aren't working? How do you know when to just say, you know what, this isn't going to work? This is a very difficult question.
I found that once I began doing this clinical supervision, which was a dialogue, it wasn't one-sided, it was a duo together. I and you together are working on your success as an educator. And it's ongoing, and it's very realistic, and it's written down and discussed. It's very specific. You want to succeed, I want to help you succeed. But it becomes very clear in time that you are succeeding or you're not succeeding. And so the decision that you should leave is best done if it's a mutual decision. In other words, I have found that I know that I'm succeeding as an administrator if I have conducted this clinical supervision well enough. My colleague says to me, I'm not making it. I'm not succeeding at this. Maybe I should not be an educator. Maybe I should be doing something else. I don't have the desire. I know I remember I had a colleague of mine who I highly respected, and I thought he was very successful as a Montessori educator. He had taken training with me, and we'd been together for many years. And about the seventh year, he surprised me and us at a faculty meeting by saying he was going to resign. And we said, why? And he said, because I feel in my heart that I want to be working with older learners. As much as I've been helpful to these young learners learn, I don't feel satisfied. I think I'd be much better working at a college level. And I had come from that long process of observing what was taking place to realize that he didn't have the zest in his life. The children were learning and they were growing, but he was not. And that's why I said again, in Montessori, it's a life-answering life. It's not just a life here and a life there. It's a dynamic relationship that we have to see. So I know I'm very successful in the process of this supervision, this clinical supervision. My colleague is saying, we're getting there, it's getting better, and there's a happiness that's growing. Well, the person's saying, it's not working. Something that needs to be a change, and no matter what we try, this is just not there. And then that faculty member comes to an agreement. And then I usually say, I think you're right.
Sometimes that can be, one of the strategies I've used is to put people with different people. Sometimes it's a matter of personality conflicts that two people just don't seem to be able to hit it off in a co-teaching, a co-educating relationship. Sometimes it's that the person may be asked to have too much responsibility too soon. So putting them maybe back as an assistant, even though it's been tried out as the head educator, maybe that wasn't the right fit. Maybe needing more modeling, and that's part of the discussion, but sometimes it has to be an executive decision, especially when children, there's a supervision issue where you find that children are maybe getting into fights more often, or that suddenly there seem to be so many incident reports from a certain learning environment where the other learning environments aren't having that many incident reports. That's when it gets a little bit where it's not maybe so easy to take your time developing somebody. There are issues about safety and that kind of thing that unfortunately they're the bottom line. And if a person can't figure out at least that level of classroom management, which really does have to do with observation and supervision, that's where I sometimes will have to make the decision and say, this isn't working out. Because I am responsible as the administrator for all the safety.
Always in Montessori, the key responsibility is towards the child and the children. As much as we have to help each other as colleagues, and that very real relationship is a life relationship, our highest priority is what's right for the child. And it may be the wrong fit, and as you were suggesting, that it might be just adjustment of knowing what age level that you should be working with or what capacity you should be working on, shouldn't be doing something else. All that we would hope would come out in this dialogue that you're having, if it's an ongoing dialogue. I mean, it's really the time commitment as an administrator, as a leader, to be meeting with faculty members on that regular basis of observing and coming together in dialogue and coming about. But the whole focus is, are you successful? Is it a good fit for you? And not just for you, but for the children, a good fit. That it's obviously the children are thriving under your mm-hmm. care. But if they're in danger and it's not working, then you do have to step in. And that should come out clearly in your communication with each other, in dialogue with each other.
And it's there's also, lastly, the issue of the philosophical alignment of, you know, what kind of Montessori school does a person want to work in? I mean, there have been people who have been on staff here who really haven't found they've been very happy because they don't like the charter school, the public school model. They're much happier in the private setting. And those folks haven't worked out very well here because they aren't willing to look at, you know, how to incorporate standardized testing as a fact of life, things like that. So I've learned to be very clear with people in interviews, you know, this is what we do. This is what we are, a charter school. We have certain autonomy, but we also have certain responsibilities. Are you okay with that? You know, is this something that you can get behind? And sometimes they'll say yes, but the reality of it after 6 or 7 months, they really can't get behind it. And that's really it's non-negotiable as a public school. People have to be able to get behind it. They don't have to like it, but they have to be able to get behind it. So those are some of the issues I've come across.
That's all part of that reality of fitting that we've been talking about and being very realistic about it. I remember when I was a child growing up in the Bronx, I was startled once when one of my friends in the street invited me home to his house for dinner. And I'd never eaten at anyone else's house but my own house. So I said, well, let me think about it. And I went home and I spoke to my mother about it. And she said, well, what's wrong with having dinner? I said, I don't know if I'm going to like what they're going to be having. She said, well, why don't you ask him what they're having for dinner first? So I went back out and I asked Tommy what they're going to have for dinner that night. And he said, spaghetti. I said, oh, I like spaghetti. So I said, yes, when I came over to his house for dinner, they have spaghetti. But his mother's spaghetti was entirely different than my mother's spaghetti sauce. I mean, it was so radically different, I could barely eat the whole thing. And I learned an important lesson that even though it seems the same, again, in the abstract, in the reality, it is what it is, what it is. And so again, in Montessori, you have Montessori in the abstract, but then what we don't want is the abstract Montessori. We want the real, actual living Montessori. And Island Village Montessori is different than Whitby School Montessori, mm-hmm. is different than Newgate Montessori. It's right. Montessori that has built up these lives and these lives in a developmental process. And we have to make sure that that is respected. And that's why I said in the very beginning that when I'm interviewing somebody, I want to make sure that they get a good taste of our spaghetti. Montessori is a special kind of spaghetti sauce, and this is our spaghetti sauce here. I want to make sure that you know and it's something that fits you and that want you to be interested in being part of that. And that becomes part of the ongoing dialogue that we have through the whole process of development. But we have to be realistic about it from both sides. We have to be honest. Communication has to do with honesty and clarity when we're talking to each other about these things, with care and respect always, so that when we do part, we part with that real understanding that we've cared for each other and helped each other, and it's the right thing to do.